I'm afraid to say anything right now. Okay. Mark chapter 10. There's a bit of an echo here. Is that okay? Mark chapter 10, we began a couple of weeks ago looking at this passage that is not a passage that is simply straightforward in one sense. There's just so many issues that are raised in this question to Jesus about divorce and then his answer about marriage. And so this morning we're still not going to get through the whole passage, and probably a couple more weeks as we take this apart and deal with issues that arise from this text and issues that we face today in our own culture and even in the church at large. But this morning I want to at least begin to speak about, let's talk about marriage. That's what Jesus does here in this passage. In Mark chapter 10, if you join me in verse 1. And he left there, that is Galilee, and went to the region of Judea and beyond the Jordan, and crowds gathered to him again. And again, as was his custom, he taught them. And Pharisees came up and, in order to test him, asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" And they said, and they're thinking of Deuteronomy 24, they said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of divorce and to send her away." That was their proof text. And Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote you this commandment." And I just pause every time I read this, because they weren't around then, but he says, "Because of your hardness of heart." It was their hardness of heart back then is still in existence in Jesus' day. "Because of your hardness of heart, that is how you would treat your wife, he wrote you this commandment." But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. "Therefore, man," and it's the word for male, "therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife," which is the word for female, "and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate." There's my answer to the divorce question, he says. And in the house, the disciples ask him again about this matter, because it was radical teaching. And he said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." I think you would agree that we need God's help to understand this. So let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you that we have an authoritative, all-sufficient scripture. In these days of great confusion, Lord, we need clarity. And so we pray today that our time of study would provide just that. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you would give us ears to hear and hearts to understand, that you would prepare us, Lord, that you would answer our own questions about this. You prepare us to engage a watching world, a questioning world, and that we would do so biblically accurately and biblically winsomely as well. So, Lord, please today instruct our minds and shape our hearts in these matters. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. When I was a very young boy, there was a very famous American football coach. American football, that game called football that you can't use your feet in. You only use your hands. His name was Vince Lombardi, and he was the coach of the Green Bay Packers, which is one of the greatest teams in the history of the National Football League. I remember hearing this story that after a particularly miserable game, the next day when the team met for practice, he pulled them together and he held up a football and he said, "Men, we're going to start from scratch. This is a football." And he went on to explain to them that we played terribly yesterday because you forgot the basics. We need to get back to the fundamentals. In a real sense, that's kind of what Jesus is doing here. He's holding up marriage and he's saying, "Guys, this is marriage." And he goes back to the fundamentals. He goes back to the basics. The Pharisees wanted to speak about divorce. Jesus says, let's talk rather about marriage. Because when you talk about marriage and understand marriage as God has designed it, in most cases, that will remove all discussion about any thought about divorce. The nation of Israel was in a spiritual mess, being led by those who were in a spiritual mess, the Pharisees. Marriages were in bad shape in the days of Jesus, and particularly wives were being terribly mistreated by husbands. And that's why Jesus talks about the hardened, their hardness of heart. Not that divorce means you have a hard heart, but how they were treating their wives that they were divorcing. And oftentimes those two things go together. When there's a spiritual malaise, there also times also follows a marital malaise. Think of the recent apostasy of Josh Harris. It's interesting, he came out one day saying he and his wife were divorcing, and the next day he comes out and says he's left the faith. I think there's a connection there. When you begin to pull away from the Lord, you begin to pull away from all of his standards and all of his rules. And so Jesus says to them, we need to talk about marriage. He's holding it up in a real sense and saying you need to understand the basics. When you understand that, then all your questioning about divorce is going to become very, very minimal. Jesus, in this passage, at least three things I want us to discuss, and that's marriage defended, marriage defined, and marriage depicted. Let's begin with marriage defended. Remember, there's something very, very diabolical taking place here. It says in verse 2, and the Pharisees came up, and in order to test him, asked, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? And the word test there is used for the first time in chapter 1, where Jesus was tested or tempted by the devil. The other two times, you find it in the book of Mark, it's again the Pharisees who are tempting Jesus. They want him to be destroyed, right? In chapter 8, he's already said that. He said the Son of Man is going to be betrayed. He's going to be killed. He said that again in chapter 9. Well, the Pharisees want him to be destroyed. And no better way to do that than to ask him about divorce, because now he's in Herod's territory. He's in Judea. And you remember that Herod's father, who didn't know who Jesus was, Herod's father wanted to destroy Jesus, so he had all the babies in Bethlehem killed. And now Herod's son, there's an opportunity for him to destroy Jesus. He's been divorced unbiblically. He's married to a woman who has no biblical basis for being divorced. And to ask this question is politically loaded. And so it's a dangerous question. I think also they were hoping that Jesus would answer it in such a way that contradicted the Pharisees, rabbinic law, and therefore he would lose a following from the people. But regardless, it's not an innocent question. They want to know, what does he say about divorce? Because they want him to be destroyed. The question of divorce is still a very, very controversial question, and we're not even going to get into all of that today. Next week, God willing, we will. And Jesus takes them back to the beginning. He asks them, what did Moses command you? And again, if they had known, if they had thought clearly, they would have... When Moses first told them, which was in Genesis 1, that he wrote these words he's going to quote. And Jesus does just that. He talks about marriage. He goes back to the beginning. He says, God made them male and female. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate. That is short, succinct, and very profound, is it not? He said, don't talk about divorce, talk about what marriage is. Marriage is about becoming one flesh with someone that you're committed to. And as you do that, then don't let man put that asunder. There's no question here of divorce, Jesus says. The question is, what is marriage? He's defending marriage. We live in a day in which there is great confusion when it comes to human sexuality and therefore about marriage. We talked a couple weeks ago about those who struggle with the whole transgender issue. I read an article this week in USA Today, and the article title, a long title, said this: my daughter thinks she's transgender. Her public school undermined my efforts to help her. It's a tragic, sad article where this family has this daughter who was struggling with the transgender issue and identifying as a boy, and they were trying to help her to see that she's not a boy, that she's made a girl. And went to a public school, and the public school is now threatening to take this child away from the parents because the public school says, no, you must identify her as a boy. That's how she wants to be identified. My oldest daughter is living in Washington, D.C. for a few months, and she wrote the other day and went to the Library of Congress, took her kids there to the children's section in the Library of Congress, and the first thing they found when they went there was a section dedicated to LGBTQ plus issues. Last night, Fountain Blue Community Church here in Johannesburg, there was a debate between James White and Graham Codrington. Graham Codrington is arguing that the Bible does not restrict marriage to a man and a woman, and Graham Codrington is a professed Christian. So this is an issue that hits home to us. We have to understand what constitutes a marriage. These are, again, I know I'm holding up a football saying this is a football. But we have to be instructed in this. And I want to suggest two things that we really need if we're going to approach this properly. Is we must approach these questions of marriage, first of all, intelligently. You know, I've heard some really bad humor over the years in churches. When it comes to the issue of homosexuality, people will say, well, God made them Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. Ha, ha, ha. Well, can I just say to you, that's not a very intelligent answer. And secondly, it's not very funny, particularly when you're dealing with people, and probably in a congregation, who are struggling with homosexuality. We need to be very, very sensitive. We need to be intelligent about this. We can't argue just with humor. We can't argue with flippant statements. We need to go back to the text like Jesus did and say, this is what the Bible says about marriage. So we must do so intelligently. We have to do the hard work of studying and reading and thinking. I read two books this week on this whole matter and realize how much more there is to learn. We must be doing our homework. What does the text actually say? Secondly, we have to speak to this issue of marriage with integrity. Now again, I mean, I'm going to play my cards out front. I think that's how they say it. Show my cards. I believe very firmly that marriage is only between a natural-born man and a natural-born woman. The Bible teaches that. I think that there is no other position to hold than that. That's what the Bible teaches. But we have to keep something in mind that in our churches, particularly our conservative churches, we can be so strong against the issue of same-sex marriage to the point we become almost very, very hard about it. Meanwhile, our churches are filled with people who have unbiblical divorces. Or we can say amen to the sermons against homosexuality, and yet at home be a tyrant as a husband. There's no integrity there. We need to be very, very careful that we're not hypocritical. Because we can be very strong about these things that we see as obvious sins, but what about the pornography on your phone? What about a host of other inconsistencies? I'm not saying we shouldn't address these issues. I'm going to address these issues. But we must do so with integrity. We must be very, very careful that we are not just cherry-picking and picking and choosing the things that we're going to be against when it comes to marital fidelity. Is that fair? Intelligently and with integrity. We have to ask the question, what constitutes a marriage? And that brings me to the next point, is marriage defined? What does constitute a marriage? Well, the first, there's three things at least I want to begin with. And the first one is simply this, that marriage is between those who are human beings. Now you're going, duh. But have you read the news lately? There are people who are marrying animals. There's a reason why God, in the Old Testament, which he never rescinded, had laws against bestiality. We live in a fallen world, and we need to say, this is a football. Marriage is between those who are human. When Jesus talks about marriage, what does he start with? He says, but from the beginning of creation, verse 6, God made them male and female. He made them male and female. In fact, it's not the whole verse of Genesis 1:27 that he's quoting. The whole verse speaks about, in the image of God made he them. He made them male and female. He made them humans. Therefore, a man, in the word there in Genesis 2, is the word ish, which is his male, shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, which is isha, which is female. And the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Marriage is between those who are human beings. Can I just say this? And I think this is a good time to bring this out, that remember what Jesus is doing here, and we don't want to lose sight of the whole context. He's not interested really in just debating the Pharisees. Jesus had no use and no time for debating Pharisees. But he always took these opportunities to disciple his people. And so what he's doing is he's training them to think biblically. He's training them about what does God say, in this case, about marriage. Jesus said, if you're going to follow me, you must deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. There's going to be a cost involved. And I just need to say this again, that I think in our day and age, certainly, there is going to be a real cost involved if we properly define, biblically define marriage. We're going to find ourselves up against a culture that's pushing against us, even legally. And I said to my daughter yesterday, we were talking about this, that I'm really not worried ever about being arrested for preaching Jesus Christ crucified. There will be people who will be scandalized by that message. It happens every week. But I don't think I'm going to be arrested because you preach Jesus Christ was crucified and risen again. I could be arrested for preaching what I'm preaching today. But what are we going to do? We must deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow Jesus. Right? He said this. We have to be very, very winsome about this. I've already done the grace group questions. And I did that to keep me on track today. Because I got far more than I have time than you have time for this morning. One of the grace group questions is discussing the matter. We need to do so truthfully, but winsomely. But if you do it so winsomely, you might still be fined. Arrested. We start where Jesus starts, with the Word of God. And God makes marriage between a man and between human beings. In fact, we know that from Genesis 2. Remember in Genesis 2:18, when God has said everything is good. And then he says it's not good that what? Man be alone. And by the way, the word man there is adamah, which means human being. It's not good that a human being be alone. It's not so much that it's not okay for a male to be alone, but it's okay for a woman to be alone. He's talking about it's not good that humanity be alone. So what does he do? God has a project, and he makes the animals from the dust of the ground, and he brings them before Adam, and Adam names them, taking dominion over them. But there was not a helper suitable for him, some translations say. Or there was not a helper fit for him. Or there was not a helper that was compatible to him. Why was that? Because they weren't human beings. And God, by the way, the first commandment was not, don't eat of this tree. The first commandment was what? Be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth. Which, by the way, we have tried to do, Jill and I, throughout our marriage, okay? We're hoping our daughters will do the same thing. Well, if they're going to be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth, that means Adam needs an Eve. So all of that in the opening chapters prove to us. And again, you say, I know this is so basic. It is basic, but people in our society are confused. Marriage is not, and I need to say this, marriage is not some kind of a social construct that we've come up with. Marriage is ordained of God. It's created by God. It's ordered by God. He makes the rules. And so marriage is between human beings. Secondly, marriage is between those of the opposite sex. And that has huge implications for the times in which we live. Again, in verse 6, but from the beginning of creation, Jesus says, God made them male and female. Now he jumps to, quoting Genesis 2:24 in verse 7 here, therefore, male and female, therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast or cleave or be glued to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. It's interesting, Jesus could have just actually left out Genesis 1:27, just quoted Genesis 2:24, and made a strong case that marriage is between those of opposite sex. But it's like I said to someone after the last time I preached, kind of jokingly, I said, when Jesus said this, it's as if he knew we'd be facing this someday. The Bible's sufficient. So Jesus goes way back, goes back further, and says, he made them male and female, therefore, male and female, when they are joined together, when they are glued together, and I think here it's a euphemism, as it is in Genesis 2:24, for sexual intercourse in the marriage relationship. So marriage is between those of the opposite sex. Jesus was reiterating the creation principle that marriage is the joining of two individuals who are of the opposite sex. Now, can I show you something that's really important? Because not everybody accepts Genesis 2:24 as an argument. In fact, I read several arguments this week which sounded pretty good. I think they were wrong. They don't believe that Genesis 2:24 actually demands that a man and a woman form a marriage. In other words, a man and a man could, because they say that the phrase one flesh means more than a physical relationship. So when I do premarital counseling and I talk about them, people being one flesh, I don't just talk about the fact that they sexually join themselves and become one flesh, but there's also one flesh in kind of psyche. You ever notice how your wife finishes your sentences? Or vice versa? You become of one heart. You're to be of one flesh financially, all those things. I do think Genesis 2:24 is, by the way, it may be true, it is true, that becoming of one flesh is more than becoming one flesh physically, but it's certainly not less than that, right? But go back to Genesis chapter 2, and let me show you something that will help you in these discussions that I think proves positively that marriage is between those of opposite sex. In Genesis chapter 2, I just mentioned this scenario here in Genesis 2:18. Then the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him. Sorry, look at verse 18 again. Then the Lord God said, it is not good, Genesis 2:18, that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him. The word helper doesn't mean something subservient, by the way. The word helper here is used more times than not in the Old Testament to describe God, our strength, our helper. A wife is to be a strong companion for her husband. But the word fit for him, some say corresponding to him or suitable for him. This is a word that it's hard to translate, but I would say the best translation would be this. It's two words, like opposite. It's a compound word, the word like and opposite. Like opposite. So like opposite. Like opposite means this. You marry someone who is like you, that is, they are a human being. And again, this whole story in Genesis 2 brings that out, where you have all these animals coming by, but there was no one like him, right? There was no, you know, he saw a lot of beautiful animals, but he said, none of these are like me. But when God brought Eve to him, and in the Hebrew, Adam responds, wow. Not really, but anyway. What he sees is someone like him, right? She was made the rib. She's like him. She's a human being. But she's also, thankfully, opposite him. That's what the word fit corresponding to means. I do think this is almost an open and shut case here. That God, who is establishing marriage, he does that by making someone like Adam and yet opposite. Human being, but sexually opposite. That is required for a marriage. And it's because she is opposite. In Genesis 2:24, therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. You know, it's interesting, even, and I'm not much of a builder, but I've been around building enough to know the terminology. It's interesting when it comes to electrics, when it comes to plumbing, you still talk about female and male ends, right? There's a like opposite. That's why you cleave, when you join together. There's a fitting there. It's a fitting design by God. So marriage demands that both parties be human beings, but it also demands that they be of the opposite sex. So it's clear, this is certainly clear to me, that the only legitimate marriage intended by God and recognized by God is heterosexual marriage. And that homosexual marriage is not an option. And when governments pass legislation defining marriage as both heterosexual and homosexual, they are trespassing God's word. So I can remember in 2015 when the United States Supreme Court ruled that in all 50 states of the United States of America, homosexual marriage was allowed. They redefined marriage. And many countries have done that. Our country allows it. That's overstepping Scripture. And I remember when this happened, the White House, some of you might remember this, the White House was lit up in the colors of a rainbow. Remember that? And again, you know, I don't want to be misheard here because there's no angst in this towards individuals. It's like, remember this guy, a pastor in California years ago, he preached a sermon something like this, and his church was vandalized the next day by some from a local homosexual community. And then when the newspaper interviewed him about that, they said, "Are you really angry?" They said, "Are you really angry about this?" And he said, "No." He said, "I wouldn't be. Why would I be angry at this? I wouldn't be angry if a blind man stepped on my toe." But he was making a really good point that I see this as clear. They don't see this. It's a spiritual issue. So there's no angst when I say this. But I do think it's tragically ironic that the rainbow exists because it was God's promise. It was his covenant of his faithfulness to not destroy the earth by water. The covenant, the rainbow was given as a sign to point us to God's covenantal faithfulness. And now it's been hijacked by a movement. And I know not everybody who struggles with homosexuality is part of that movement, so I'm not saying that. But there is a movement that has hijacked that, which really mocks covenantal faithfulness, the covenant of marriage. Marriage is between two human beings who are sexually opposite. That's the only kind of marriage the Bible recognizes. It's the only kind of marriage God recognizes. It's the only kind of marriage, therefore, that our Lord and Savior recognizes. And as his disciples, it's the only ones we're allowed to recognize. This raises all kinds of issues that I don't even have prepared here to deal with, but you think about some of you are in a situation, you're invited to go to a gay wedding. Those put us in situations where we have to, and sometimes it's family members. How do we respond to that? These are issues we need to really be thinking through and praying through. I personally could not do that because I'd feel like I was giving sanction to something. But I tell you what, after the wedding, When that couple invites me to their house for a meal, I'm going. Because they need help. They need to be reached. But thirdly, and this is a quicker point, third, in marriage, husband and wife come from different families. The man leaves his father and mother and joins himself to a wife. I've married four of my five daughters, and each time when I've done the premarital counseling, I've said to the hopeful son-in-law that keep in mind that the text says the man leaves father and mother. And I kind of smile. And I say, obviously, there's an implication here that so does the daughter, but the responsibility is on the man. And in all seriousness, it's really interesting to me that these Pharisees, who were hardened to hearts the way they treated their wives, tell us about divorce. Moses said we could do it. And Jesus puts the onus back on them and says, you're supposed to leave and cleave to her. Make it work. Now, obviously, there's a sense in which Adam and Eve didn't come from different families. And, you know, the question people think is you're going to stump somebody. Atheists are going to stump us by saying, where did Cain get his wife? I love it when people say to me, yeah, okay, if you believe that Bible, where did Cain get his wife? And I always say, his sister. That's where he got her. But it's interesting that years later, when Moses wrote this, he's writing this hundreds of years after creation. When Moses wrote these words, he's also writing other words in Exodus, Leviticus, and Deuteronomy that forbids incest. And there's a whole lot of reasons for that. But that is the three parameters that I see in Genesis about what makes a marriage. Those parameters. You must be human beings. You must be of opposite sex. And you cannot be from the same family. But we're not done yet. I think that there's something else that's very, very important. We need to ask and answer the question, what actually constitutes a marriage? Those are the three parameters, very important. You must be a human being, you must be of the opposite sex, you must come from different families. But what constitutes two people getting married? So for many people in our culture, I think I mentioned this a few weeks ago, they think if you slept with somebody, therefore you're married. Now, Paul does say in 1 Corinthians 6:16, he speaks about if you join yourself to a prostitute, he said, don't you know you become one flesh? And you do become one flesh in a sexual way and in other ways. And that's why Paul warns and says fornication is a sin against the body. But sleeping together does not constitute you being married to a person. If that were the case, by the way, then that means somebody who was raped would be married to that person. Or by virtue of an incestual rape, again, married. No. By the way, I think we have to be really careful about this. There's this very traditional idea that if you slept with somebody, you must marry them. I think we want to be really careful about that kind of counsel. But what constitutes a marriage? I think simply it's this. Marriage requires willing consent, willing commitment, willing consummation. Marriage requires willing, I put it this way, marriage requires willing covenantal consent sealed by sexual consummation. In other words, somebody can't be married against their will. And that happens in our world. You read about these 12-year-olds that are forced to marry men in different parts of the world. That's not a marriage recognized by God. In fact, that's rape in most cases. Marriage is a willing consent, willing commitment, followed by willing sexual consummation. And when those requirements are met, a marriage has been established by God. Now that raises all kinds of questions. You know, I told you this was not going to be easy. This is not simple. There's all kinds of issues that are raised. Is it for a person to be married, must there be an officiator? Where does the state come in with this? The state licensing marriage. I don't know when the state, when the government got involved in issuing marriage licenses, but there is nothing in Scripture that calls for that. You don't have to have government permission to be married. Now understand this, that the laws of the government, the laws of the state, whatever you want to call it, are there, ideally, to protect you in a marriage. And so for that reason, when I marry people, I have Gary, who is a marriage officer, I have him do that. I'm not a marriage officer, thankfully. I say to Gary, go to Gary. There's nothing wrong with that. But that provides legal protection. But if you have two individuals who are human beings, opposite of each other sexually, from different families, who are willing to make a covenant, make their vows, and then to consummate that, guess what? The Bible says they're joined together, they're married. With or without a license. A license is important for other reasons, but it's just like a church. A church can benefit by adhering to some particular things that the government offers to a church, but if it doesn't, it still exists as a church. Secondly, and this may shock you, you don't need to have a minister at the service to be married. It doesn't have to be a church wedding. I've had many people over the years ask me if I would perform their marriage ceremonies, and I only do that for church members. And so, and particularly if they're unbelievers, I just say to them, you don't want a church wedding. Because a church wedding signifies this, which you don't believe, but you can still be married. Marriage is a creation ordinance, whether you're saved or not. I think it's a wonderful thing to involve your church when you are exchanging your vows, but the church, there's nothing in the Scriptures that say that you have to be married by the church. So, to be married does not require the state, doesn't require the church. Further, can I say this? To be married, and you'll be glad to hear this, doesn't require a lot of money. And I know we'd all chuckle when I say that. But let me meddle a little bit, okay? Now, I have five daughters, and I know they all think I'm a Neanderthal. But I think today we have lost the plot. And weddings have become about a celebration, which is fine, or a ceremony. But the covenantal aspect is seen as just a very, very small part of that. If you come to a lot of weddings that I do, you will hear me consistently and persistently in my message talking about a covenantal commitment. Because that is the most important thing. And when two people who are humans, I guess that's goes without saying, when two human beings who are of the opposite sex, who come from different families, want to make a covenantal commitment, then do it. But to wait a year and a year and a half because you want to have this big party, don't do that. Start your home. Make the covenant. I mean, so many married couples, and I don't know if that's a problem within our own church, I don't think so, but I know of cases where couples are in debt for years after they get married because of this. And wedding venues litter our land, and I use that word deliberately. You know what? And we're making it harder for our young people. We don't need a lot of money. And Jill used to say this, when we got married, the only furnished room in our house was the bathroom. We just lived on love, right? We were hungry, but we lived on love, all right? But in all seriousness, and I'm really not trying to meddle here, I am trying to help. I think we put so much cultural pressure on this. Just stop that. You know what? You can use this building. I know it's not beautiful, but you know what happens here in this building? That's beautiful. I wish we did have a hall so that, you know, we can have the everybody here, and if it's raining, you still are covered and you have a wonderful celebration. I know somebody in this church said to me that when they get married, what they're going to do is after a Sunday morning service, come forward and say, we want to exchange our vows, because they want the whole church just to be involved in this. That's a wonderful thing. I was in a church once that did that. This couple came forward afterwards and the pastor married them in front of the whole congregation. It was wonderful. And by the way, as a father of brides, oh, that's cheap. Whenever my daughters get married, we usually have this little thing where we watch Father of the Bride the night or two before the wedding with Steve Martin. And the kids just all kind of over, you know, I talked about how they, at that church, they all kind of eyeballs looking at me. When we're watching that movie, they're all looking at me because that's me. It's Mr. Cheapskate. But in all seriousness, marriage is a gift from God. Let's not complicate it. Let's not delay it needlessly. I think the whole thing of libola, we're going to discuss that at Grace Groups this week. That can be a real problem. It can set young people up for temptation, sexual temptation. We need to be thinking these things through. What does the Bible say about this? Well, since I've already been controversial, let me say one more thing before I bring this to a close. And I have this heading in my notes called "The More the Merrier." What about polygamy? What does the Bible say about polygamy? Our culture has those who have polygamous marriages. Somebody is converted and they have two or three wives. Or one of the wives is converted and she has married to a man who has two other wives. How do you counsel them? Is that a legitimate marriage? Is a polygamous marriage a legitimate marriage? Now hear me carefully. If they're human beings, the opposite sex, from different families, and they have a willing consent and a willing commitment, and they made that willing covenant, and it's consummated willingly, then I believe in God's eyes they are married. And what God has joined together, let not man put asunder. If we're going to deal with biblical principles, then you have to recognize that in a polygamous marriage, those people are married. Now that you're all breathing again, hear this. I don't believe that's God's plan A. And it's interesting how, though there was polygamous marriages in the Old Testament, and God recognized those. In fact, so many of the laws in Deuteronomy about marriage were to protect wives in those polygamous marriages. I can't think of a polygamous situation in the Old Testament that seemed to me to be a happy one. Can you? But once they were married, God expected marital fidelity. It's interesting, in the New Testament, when Jesus talks about marriage, he doesn't go to some polygamous thing. He goes back to the beginning, doesn't he? He goes back to the beginning because this is the way it should be. Well, because we live in a fallen, broken world, there's lots of things that exist that are not that great. It's kind of like this. If you make a very unwise decision to purchase something, you make that unwise decision and you sign a contract, though it was unwise, maybe even a wrong purchase because you couldn't afford it, guess what? You're still contractually bound. I would argue the same for a polygamous marriage. It is interesting what Paul says, that if a man's going to be an elder, he must be the husband of one wife. We've checked that out with Anton. It does include fidelity to the one wife, but obviously it would mean no. Why? And that's interesting, because if elders are to be spiritual examples, and Paul says it's important you only have one wife, then that would assume that's the best pattern, right? So please don't misunderstand me. I'm not arguing for polygamy. I would strongly argue against polygamy, but I'm saying that when somebody is in that marriage, it's a recognized marriage by God. And we want to think these things very clearly as we're counseling people about these matters. That does bring me to my last point, and I'm just going to quickly deal with this because time is running out. Is marriage depicted? We'll come back to this perhaps next week. But why was Jesus so concerned about marriage? Why was he so strong about what God has joined together, let not man separate? Why did Jesus defend marriage? I think Jesus defended marriage because, and he goes to Genesis 2:24, because in Genesis 2:24, there is a mystery underlying that verse. For this cause shall a man leave father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. There was a mystery underlying that which nobody understood in the Old Covenant. But years later, after Jesus comes and sheds his blood for his bride, the church, and brings his bride to himself, and joins himself to his bride in this one flesh union, Paul writes and says, after quoting Genesis 2:24 and Ephesians 5:32, says, and I am telling you, that when Moses wrote this, I'm paraphrasing, when I am telling you, when Moses wrote this, he was speaking of Christ and the church. You see, marriage is important to Jesus because human marriage depicts, it pictures this wonderful relationship between Jesus Christ and his bride, the church. His bride that he won to himself. His bride that he lived for, and he literally died for, and he literally rose for. The one that he is in a one-flesh union with because of his relationship with his bride, the church. Because of that, he was saying, make your marriage work. I'll deal with this in the weeks ahead, but Christians, there's a lot riding on our marriages because they're a picture. They're a picture. Christ's undying love for his church. His unconditional, indissoluble, unending love for his bride, the church. Aren't you glad that he will never leave you nor forsake you? Amen. And that's what our marriages are to depict. An unconditional love. That we are joined together by God. And no man can separate. Aren't you glad that your sin can't separate you from God in Christ? No one can separate you from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. And that is what is to be depicted by our marriages. That is why I am persuaded Jesus was so passionate about marriage because of what it pictured. But if you're here today and you're not a Christian, can I urge you today that there is an invitation going out to you today from Jesus Christ saying, be mine. Be mine. Turn from your sin. Believe on me who died and rose again and interceding for those who repent and believe. Come to him today and enjoy, as we will in a moment, a foretaste of the marriage supper of the Lamb. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word that is all sufficient. We pray for better insight into Scripture, that we would know what we believe, that what we believe lines up with what you have revealed. And help us, Lord, to be able to lovingly, graciously, winsomely, and yet steadfastly, firmly engage with a confused society. And Lord, our goal in this is not just to win debates about marriage. Our goal is to win people to Christ. And so, Lord, I pray that you would help our country to be of a right mind because they have a right heart, being renewed by the Spirit of God, experiencing the new birth in Christ. And Lord, teach us, we pray. Use us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.